Well, it is so good to see some of your faces again. Welcome back, Shirley. Welcome back, Gomes family. Glad to be able to have you back. Some of you have been sick for several weeks. Good to see you well again. Well, I bring greetings from cold Phoenix. I'm not sure that there is such a thing. I know you guys, it is cold sometimes in Phoenix, and it was one of those rare times. 56 degrees, but it was cold for a short bit in Phoenix. But I was there over the last few days at a conference, and they bring greetings. It's neat to see church bodies that have families that look just like you, and so they ask the same questions, they are going through some of the same issues, and they are a vibrant body out there in Westside Phoenix at Heritage and at Eastside Phoenix at Legacy. So it was good to have them all there together at a conference. Well, our passage today is Daniel chapter 10. And we're going to read the first 9 verses, if you wouldn't mind standing as we read God's word, his holy, inspired, inerrant word. In the 3rd year of Cyrus, king of Persia, a message was revealed to Daniel, whose name was called Belteshazzar. The message was true, but the appointed time was long, and he understood the message and had understanding of the vision. In those days, I, Daniel, was mourning 3 full weeks. I ate no pleasant food, no meat or wine came into my mouth, nor did I anoint myself at all, till 3 whole weeks were fulfilled. Now on the 24th day of the 1st month, as I was by the side of the great river, that is the Tigris, I lifted my eyes and looked, and behold, a certain man clothed in linen, whose waist was girded with the gold of Uphaz. His body was like beryl, his face like the appearance of lightning, his eyes like torches of fire, his arms and feet like burnished bronze in color, and the sound of his words like the voice of a multitude. And I, Daniel, alone saw the vision, for the men who were with me did not see the vision. But a great terror fell upon them, so that they fled to hid themselves. Therefore I was left alone when I saw this great vision, and no strength remained in me, for my vigor was turned to frailty in me, and I retained no strength. And yet I heard the sound of his words. And while I heard the sound of his words, I was in a deep sleep on my face, with my face to the ground. Let's pray. Father, we acknowledge that this is your word, that it is authoritative over us. It is not man's words, and so we cannot just read with a complacency and with a nonchalance that would dismiss it. Pray instead that we would take it with reverence, that we would apply it to our lives, and that we would leave changed. It's in Jesus' name we pray these things. Amen. You may be seated. Well, if you've been with us through our study of Daniel, you may have noticed that Daniel's later visions expand upon earlier ones. And this feature is particularly evident as we come to these last 3 chapters. They each together form a unit, and they contain a single vision. Up to this point, the visions have been handled in 1 chapter each, but here is a lengthy vision presented in chapter 11, to which there's a preface in chapter 10, which is what we're covering today, and a postscript, if you will, in chapter 12. And chapter 10 tells how the vision came to Daniel. Remember from last time that God revealed to Daniel in the vision recorded in chapter 9 how Israel would rebel once more and ultimately be judged by God. Even the promised Messiah would be cut off. And this prompted Daniel to mourn over his people. We're told that the time is now the 3rd year of Cyrus, which is 1 to 2 years after the first group of exiles had returned to Jerusalem under the newly appointed governor of Judah, whose name was Zerubbabel, and Joshua, the high priest. And this first group arrived back in Jerusalem around the summer of 536 B.C., and by the fall had cleared the temple area, had resumed the daily sacrifices. And in the following spring, they laid the foundation of the temple, but then the work stopped. It stopped for 15 years until God sent the prophet Haggai, what we have as one of our minor prophets, but realize we only call them minor because they're shorter books, sent Haggai to instruct the remnant to resume the work, which they did. And perhaps Daniel had heard that the work of rebuilding the temple had stopped. And perhaps that added to his trouble. So that's the context of the morning's passage. It's the 24th day of the first month of the year. If you know your Jewish calendar, then you may know that that is 10 days after Passover. And Daniel says that he has been praying for 3 weeks. So what does that mean? It means that he started his prayers approximately a week before Passover. And I can imagine that Passover, as a reminder of God's goodness to Israel in contrast to his vision of Daniel 9, the possible news that work had stopped on rebuilding the temple in Jerusalem, all of that had to be influential in Daniel's decision to pray for 3 straight weeks. And at the end of this time, while standing at the bank of the Tigris River, he saw an angel. Now, don't get so caught up in the following description of the angel that you miss the part that Daniel did, in fact, mourn and fast and pray for 3 weeks. Children, have you ever fasted for a day? I'll bet some of you fasted a meal. But a whole day? Now, can you imagine for 2 days or a week, 3 weeks fasting? We've already seen in previous chapters how Daniel's faithful commitment to his people has led him to be diligent and vigilant in his prayers. That should challenge us. We ourselves have a hard enough time, don't we, being motivated to fast and pray when our own brothers and sisters of not only this local church, whom we see every week, are struggling, but our brothers and sisters in the church throughout the world, when it suffers. But that was not the case with Daniel. Daniel had a sense of solidarity with his people and with the broader church. And when it suffered, when she suffered, he suffered. And now thinking about the angel that Daniel did see, angels are not usually described in much detail in Scripture, but this angel is described as being clothed in linen, whose waist was girded with gold. Body like that of beryl, his face like the appearance of lightning, his eyes like torches of fire, his arms and feet like burnished bronze in color, and the sound of his words like the voice of a multitude, it says. And this figure is so overpowering that Daniel's strength flees away and he falls to the ground as if he is in a deep sleep. And even when the angel comes to him and touches him and raises him up, he remains trembling. And then the angel spoke according to verse 12, and you can read it there. It says, "Do not fear, Daniel, for from the first day that you set your heart to understand and to humble yourself before your God, your words were heard. And I have come because of your words. But the prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me 21 days, and behold, Michael, one of the chief princes, came to help me, for I had been left alone there with the kings of Persia. Now I have come to make you understand what will happen to your people in the latter days, for the vision refers to many days yet to come." And we read this passage, and we can't help but be struck that it is a remarkable passage. When Daniel had started praying 3 weeks earlier, God had sent this powerful heavenly messenger to bring him the vision of the future, which we find in chapter 11, but we are told that the prince of the Persian kingdom, whom we must understand to be an evil but correspondingly powerful spiritual principality, resisted him so that for 3 weeks he was not able to come to Daniel. Now stop and think about that for a moment. An angel was resisted for 3 weeks mean, it was an angel that decimated the Ammonites and that entire army in the valley before Jehoshaphat and the Israelites crested the hill to see that they were all dead. It was an angel, a single angel, that went through and wiped out by plague a large percentage of David's kingdom in judgment over his sin. A single angel. And there are other passages that are similar of the power of angels, and yet we read that the prince of the Persian kingdom resisted him for 3 weeks so that he was not able to come to Daniel. And we're further told that the resistance was so strong that Michael the archangel had to help. Does that sound unbelievable? Angels being resisted, multiple angels required to overcome the resistance, all in what amounts to a real-time, three-week-long effort, 21 days, that's incredible to me. And although it's different from anything we find elsewhere in the Word of God, in a sense, because we get this momentary glimpse of that powerful resistance, nevertheless, it fits what we are taught about spiritual warfare in passages in the Scripture. For example, in Job, first two chapters are one part of this teaching on spiritual warfare, and they don't speak of outright struggle, but they show a scene, as you know, in heaven, in which the devil and his angels appear before the throne of God, and in which God questions Satan about his righteous servant Job. And he says, "Have you considered Job?" He says, "There's no one on earth like him. He is blameless and upright, a man who fears God and shuns evil." And Job, though he may be that way, Satan replies that it's only because God has blessed him. It's only because God has protected him. And so Satan challenges God to take away his possessions. He predicts that Job will then curse God. And as a result, God gives permission to Satan, but Job does not curse God. And even after he's given the permission to take away Job's health, Job doesn't sin. Instead, he asks, "Shall we accept good from God and not trouble?" You know that story, most of you. Perhaps you know the story in 1 Kings 22, where we read about Micaiah, a true prophet of the Lord, versus 400 kind of pretenders, if you will, that are prophets for King Ahab. And Micaiah tells Ahab that he had seen the host of heaven standing around God's throne, suggesting to God how Ahab might be lured into attacking Ramoth-Gilead and meeting his death there. And there are a number of suggestions. But an evil spirit says, "I will go out and be a lying spirit in the mouths of all of his prophets." And that's what God allows to happen. We get up, we eat, we go to work. We come back, we eat, we go to sleep. Get up, we eat. we could keep going, right? The routine, mundane nature of life. And punctuating all of that is this amazing spiritual realm of reality. I could go on and I could talk about Elisha allowing his servant a momentary view of what is the reality around them with all of the angels and the chariots that actually are protecting them against and causing confusion against the army that is out around the city. In the next to last book of the Minor Prophets, there's a great scene. Zechariah sees the high priest Joshua, which is the same high priest I mentioned at the beginning that went back with the first remnant from Babylon. Joshua is in this vision pictured as standing before God's altar, and Satan is there accusing him. And Joshua is clothed in filthy clothes. You know, when I see that kind of a picture in Zechariah, I think, wow, I wonder if I am in being accused before God. You ever think about that? Whether you might be right now being accused before God by Satan or someone else, and they're saying, look at what so-and-so is doing. He doesn't love you. She doesn't love you. Here's Joshua, the high priest. He's clothed in filthy clothes that are symbolic of his and the nation's sin. But God rebukes Satan. And the angel accompanying Joshua says to those standing by, take off his filthy clothes. And in place of the original clothes, he is given rich garments and a clean turban, which is symbolic of the righteousness of God that is imputed to him. And what does this all reveal to us? It reveals that throughout human history, while events are unfolding, there has been a parallel unfolding of events in the spiritual realm. Accusations by Satan before the throne against the saints, requests for opportunities to test and sift the people, resistance against God's messengers, the angels. In Revelation 12, an actual battle is described involving the same Michael. The text says that there is war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon and his angels fight back, but the dragon was not strong enough, and they lost their place in heaven, and the great dragon was hurled down, that ancient serpent called the devil or Satan, who leads the whole world astray, hurled to the earth and his angels with him. And then I heard a loud voice in heaven say, says John, now have come the salvation and the power and the kingdom of our God. For the accuser of our brothers, who accuses them before our God day and night, has been hurled down. Day and night, did you catch that? The sense of all the time, a perpetual accusation against the saints of God. And I'm reminded of Ephesians 3, and I'm not going to go into detail about that, but just the fact that Paul says that this mystery, which is the church, is being revealed to whom? The wisdom of God to the principalities and the powers that look in to see whether the wisdom of God is successful. Friends, don't be distracted by the mundane nature and routine nature of your lives and forget that you play this important part of displaying the wisdom of God, and you are being accused. In the concluding portion of Ephesians, in which the Apostle Paul encourages Christians to arm themselves with God's armor and stand against Satan's power, we are told that we play a part in these battles. Paul writes, be strong in the Lord and his mighty power, and put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood. You see, we always think that our struggle is against flesh and blood, don't we? To us, that's the most important, most overriding struggle. And yet Paul says that the difference between the fleshly battle and what we fight in the spiritual realm is so significant a gap and so significant a difference that he's able to say your struggle is not against flesh and blood. But Paul, you don't realize what I'm struggling with. My relationships and with my job and work and everything else that I'm doing, I have struggles every single day. I can hardly get up. My struggles are so bad. Well, Paul says, your struggles are not against flesh and blood. Your struggle is against the powers of the dark world and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. And that's why he says, put on the full armor of God. And many of you know that armor, right? You could name it, the pieces of the armor. According to these verses, spiritual warfare continues, and you are the target because Paul talks about these flaming arrows. Unfortunately, although perhaps for our own good, we are not told much more about the spiritual realm in the Bible. The passages I've read are just glimpses. We are told, however, what we need to know. We are told a little more about angels, and we don't have time to go thoroughly into that either, but just know that the godly angels are mentioned in the Old Testament over 100 times, and in the New Testament more than 160 times. So things aren't just in the Old Testament period, and then suddenly stop with the coming of Christ. We're told that they are God's messengers. That's what the word angel means. They are immortal, that they do not die, therefore, though they are created beings. They exist in vast numbers. Revelation speaks of thousands upon thousands, a very myriad of angels. They possess the elements of personality, for they render intelligent worship to God. Some of these qualities are indicated by the terms that are used to describe them in Scripture, things like the heavenly host, principalities, powers, dominions, authorities, thrones, and alongside these godly angels is a host of those that fell with Satan. And the Bible describes them as a terrifying force. Not to induce terror in you. That's not meant to scare you, but to warn you so that you may draw close to God for protection, if you will, for strength. Mary Magdalene alone is said to have been delivered from 7 of them. We're told in Luke 8 that a great number, simply called legion, had possessed a man that Christ encountered in the territory of the Gerasenes. Calvin wrote of God's purpose in telling us of this host. He wrote, "We have been forewarned that an enemy relentlessly threatens us. An enemy who is the very embodiment of rash boldness, of military prowess, of crafty wile, of untiring zeal and haste, of every conceivable weapon, of skill in the science of warfare. We must then bend our every effort to this goal. Let us not be overwhelmed by carelessness or faint-heartedness, but with courage rekindled, let us stand our ground in combat." Stand our ground in combat. Like I said, we just want to go about our work and our schooling and our homemaking. We just want to be left alone to do our duties. Combat, we leave that for the people who actually want to fight in the military. And friends, it gets worse. At the head of the enemy is the devil, whom the Bible describes as a powerful foe. There may be many jokes about the devil, probably some inspired by him himself, to make us think lightly of him. But he is evil and real and personal. And of course, don't make the opposite error and over-exaggerate his power. Don't think in any way that he is more or less the equal of God, like some kind of opposing yin-yang, opposing force, balance. He is not a spiritual counterpart of God. God is God, and there is no other. Every other being has been created by God and is therefore limited for the simple reason that very existence is sustained by God. God is omnipotent. He is all-powerful. The devil is not. God can do anything he wishes to do. The devil, like the rest of us, can do only what God permits him to do. Not even hell is the devil's. God created hell as the place where he will place Satan. God is omnipotent. He is omnipresent. He is everywhere at once. David said, "Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, there you are. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me. That cannot be said of Satan. The devil can only be in one place at one time. And consequently, he either tempts one person in one place at one time or must extend his influence through the other beings that fell with him. And the result is, although the devil's influence is widespread, it's probably the case that neither you nor anyone you know has ever been directly tempted by the devil. In fact, in all the Bible, we only know of 6 individuals that were tempted by Satan himself. Eve, Job, Jesus Christ, Judas, Peter, and Ananias. No doubt there have been others, but these are the only ones that the Bible tells us specifically. God is omniscient. He knows everything that is untrue of Satan. Satan does not know everything, although he knows a lot more than us. Many times I have said he is the most doctrinally correct being in the universe outside of the Lord because he knows a lot more than us, and he knows the truth, even though he rejects the truth. So we must be realistic that Satan is a great and powerful foe. And yet we are not to tremble before him. We are steadfastly to resist him in the strength and armor of God. And we are to stand boldly knowing that the word of God and the kingdom have already prevailed. I like the way Martin Luther saw it. He saw himself as engaged in this great battle, where the world seemed to always be behind him, but behind that world was the power of this spiritual realm, and yet he did not fear. And his hymn, "A Mighty Fortress Is Our God," you know the words, right? Say them in your mind as I say them. "And though the world with devils filled should threaten to undo us, we will not fear, for God hath willed his truth to triumph through us. The prince of darkness grim, we tremble not for him. His rage we can endure, for lo, his doom is sure. One little word shall fell him." What's that one little word? Well, it's simply the powerful word of God. As Luther goes on to say, "The spirit and the gifts are ours through him who with us sideth. Let good and kindred go, this mortal life also. The body they may kill, but God's truth abideth still. His kingdom is forever." You see, Luther was realistic enough to know that the devil and his forces are capable of stirring up such hatred against God's saints that we may well lose goods and kindred and even our lives, but in this warfare, God is still sovereign. And God's truth and his kingdom will prevail. We may lose lives, goods, friends, but we have an eternal inheritance. And that's what the angel came to tell Daniel. Like us, Daniel saw only the earthly scene and his mind was troubled. But the angel reminds Daniel, God is in control of history. It's the great theme of this book. God is in control. And Daniel is strengthened by that knowledge. Friends, it's important that we have a proper perspective of the devil's power if we are to withstand his schemes. He really seems to only have 2 basic strategies of operation. The first is the demon behind every bush syndrome, if you will, where he tries to persuade people that he is all-powerful and that to resist him is therefore pointless. Some read passages like "the devil is a roaring lion going about seeking whom he can devour" and think that all they can do is run and hide from Satan. That strategy is very effective, especially in developing countries. The work in Myanmar is, Pastor Hine is going to see in just a few weeks, the work in Myanmar, the key struggle for those with regard to Christianity is to show that God's power is greater than the devil's power. because so much of the country is ruled by spiritism and animism outside of the cities. We may not in America deal as much with the direct manifestation of evil in the form of things like these primitive beliefs and a fear of the devil, but there is often a tendency to give Satan too much credit. There are many who blame every negative event on the work of the demonic. The alcoholic is possessed by a spirit of alcoholism. Someone is bitter, she's possessed by a spirit of bitterness. You've heard those phrases before. Even closer to the interests of Daniel 10, difficulties in presenting the gospel in particular places are attributed to a territorial spirit blocking the work there. And while it is undoubtedly true that Satan and his forces are behind much that is in our world, we should certainly pray for God to frustrate their efforts. This approach, I believe, gives Satan too much credit. The angel does not urge Daniel to pray against the prince of Persia as if there's a possibility that the prince could continue to prevail. He doesn't say, "You got to keep praying, Daniel, because we might not be able to get past that prince." Rather, the proper answer is to recognize and remind ourselves of God's overwhelming power. And just as the angel says to Daniel, "Be strong in the Lord," so Paul urges the Ephesians, "Be strong in the Lord and his mighty power." You have the power, even when evil does its worst, to be able to stand. No temptation is irresistible, no matter what it may appear to us, because the awesome power of God is at work in you to make you a new people. The second strategy by Satan is actually the exact opposite of that. That's the one he likes in our country. He shrinks out of sight altogether. It's all too convenient for him when people don't believe in his existence and don't take him seriously and say there is no hell, there is no devil. He can carry out his work unsuspected and appear as an angel of light and enslave us not by dominant force but by sweet seduction. And the answer to that the strategy is to see the reality of what Daniel saw in chapter 10, to be convinced that there is a devil, that there is a very real power, that there are forces that resist God. But don't remember that you don't struggle. Remember that you don't struggle alone. Now, the scene in Daniel is awe-inspiring, perhaps a little frightening when we try to really understand it. What part do we possibly play in all of this? These heavenly beings contending and struggling against one another. Well, the answer lies in Daniel's revolutionary act that triggered the vision in the first place. Are you ready for it? It's the action that can prompt some of the most powerful beings in God's creation to contend with one another. Wait for it. Daniel prayed. When we pray, we who are so weak in comparison, trembling human beings, we engage in the cosmic conflict in a way that has vast and often unseen repercussions. I don't know if you've thought about prayer that way. For example, when I read Ephesians 6 earlier, how many of you in your minds were able to list off the spiritual armor? You were able to say, well, there's the breastplate of righteousness and the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit and the belt of truth, right? The sandals of the gospel of peace. Y'all know that list? How many of you knew and remembered that that is not the end of that section? It's even listed in our Bibles, the armor of God, right? And we think of it as a passage that simply tells us about this armor that we're putting on to do warfare as a properly dressed soldier in God's army. But what does the soldier do? He doesn't just take the sword of the Spirit as the offensive weapon, which is what we always say. What does Paul say that this now-dressed soldier does? he prays without ceasing. You got dressed up to pray. That's doing warfare. That's what Paul says in the face of overwhelming situations and unbearable trials and frustrating difficulties. What do? You don't just take up the sword of spirit, which is truth. It's a very powerful weapon, the word of God. There is no doubt about that. But you are also to pray without ceasing. And don't miss the very important role of the warrior of God. Friends, what do we usually do? We pray rarely with large requests, don't we? We're usually limited by small imaginations and little faith. By our own predetermined explanations of how God should solve our problems. We don't pray for big things because we often don't believe that God can or will do them. It's especially true during those difficult and discouraging times. We pray for small sinners to become Christians, but not for the big sinners. We pray for victory over small sins in our lives, but we leave the large ingrained habits untouched. We pray for change in the small corner of this part of our state, but we don't pray for the whole country or even the world. Certainly don't fast for 3 weeks and mourn over the state of the church. But we serve a great and mighty God who makes kingdoms rise and fall. He controls the events of world history. And this God chooses to work in response to the prayers of his people. Prayer literally moves heaven and earth. The moment you started to pray, Daniel, I came. I was resisted. Michael had to come and help. But you kept praying, and I kept coming. Friends, we have to have this bigger view of life. And ultimately, though, our victory doesn't rest on our faithfulness. And here's, I don't want you to get all of this and say, okay, I am that warrior. These things depend on me. It's true that God, the God who created you and sustains you, the God who is in control of all things, does respond to your prayers, and he has ordained it to be that way. But it is also true that the victory is in Jesus Christ. He won the victory for us, and he took his stand all alone. He wore God's armor in the decisive battle for our souls. He prayed for us the great high priestly prayer, and he went before us, the captain of our salvation, for the joy that was set before him. He rose from the dead. He ascended on high. He stands at the right hand of the Father, and he pleads on our behalf, and he is the one for whom all things consist. And at the cross, Satan did his worst against him and was defeated. And since Jesus won that victory on the cross, nothing and no one can stand against him. And that is the great cause for rejoicing and praise in prayer. It's why we pray in Jesus' name. The decisive battle is over and God has won the victory. But you are still to pray. But as you pray, you're in an even better position than Daniel. While you are to be broken and mourning over the state of the church and the state of our nation and all of these things that are worthy to be praying for, you are not in a state, if you will, even of ignorance. Even though the angel reveals some things to Daniel, Daniel didn't see Jesus Christ. He didn't know what it meant to say that the battle was finally won at the cross. He was not indwelt in that same way that you are now by the Holy Spirit and standing in the presence of God covered by the righteousness of Christ. Friends, you are the saints of Daniel chapter 7. You are the saints in whose hand the dominion and the rule of the kingdom of God have been given over to show that the Son of Man has been given dominion over all things. You are the saints of whom the church has said will stand against the gate of hell, and it will not prevail, that gate, that power of Satan, because of what God has done in you. And if this is true of us, the church and his saints, should we not, standing in that resplendent armor, which is the glory and righteousness of Jesus Christ, should we not even more have cause to pray? The victory is won and the battle is won. And God delights in the prayers and responds to the prayers of his saints. There is work to be done, and you are mighty warriors. Let us fight. Let us leave behind the mundane nature of our lives. And let's remember that there's far more to reality than we think. Let's pray.